Hi, everyone. I just wanted to kind of go over the definition of subject matter jurisdiction for those that don't know what it is. The court can adjudicate a dispute if two conditions are satisfied. It must have jurisdiction over the parties, and it must have jurisdiction over the type of legal issue in dispute. So it's not enough to live in the state, you know, of Nevada, or for something to have happened in Nevada. That court also has to have jurisdiction over the subject. And the subject matter that Ammon Bundy wants to discuss, wants to argue, is the legality of the law. Okay, is it in compliance with the U.S. Constitution? And I read over his case, and I don't think he mentioned the Nevada Constitution, but I even question the law when I look at the Nevada Constitution too. And we'll get into that more as I read his update, but I just wanted to kind of explain that you can't go to traffic court to argue for a divorce. They don't have subject matter jurisdiction, the court doesn't, over divorces. They deal with speeding tickets and things of that nature. So, and that's what he's arguing. This court doesn't have the jurisdiction over this subject matter. So when cases go to court, these ranchers go to court against the BLM or whatever, it's automatically assumed that the BLM has the authority to do what they're doing. I have not been able to find any Supreme Court case that says what this, you know, the federal government has a right to manage or the authority to manage these lands. So it's been 150 years in Nevada, and according to the Nevada Constitution, these lands were supposed to be disposed of a long time ago, but at some point the federal government hung on to them and decided to start managing them while people of the states were using them. And it's caused a lot of issues even in the state with the city, like the city of Las Vegas, putting in roads and sidewalks and things of that nature, because stuck in the middle of city property is a piece of federal land. And they can't take that land through eminent domain because it's supposedly owned by the federal government. So you'll see in Las Vegas, in Clark County, and Nye County, and so many of the towns and cities here in Nevada, you will see houses, there are no sidewalks. You'll see where the, you know, blacktop ends and gravel begins, and it's because you've reached federal property. And no improvements have been made, nothing's been done to that land, but adjacent to it is city land, and it's been improved. So the resolution to the ordinance in the Nevada Constitution discusses this also, the burden it's placed on the city to expand, and also, you know, like what these ranchers have gone through, this BLM, if they had their way, they will tax the hell out of a rancher until he can't afford to do business anymore, and they're taxed through permit fees, you know. And that's one thing the in the Affordable Care Act, the Supreme Court said it doesn't have to be called a tax to be a tax. It could be called a shared payment plan, you know, or a shared payment or whatever. It's still a tax, and that's how the government was allowed to keep that tax in there. It was a tax, even though Obama said it wasn't, it was a tax. So these grazing fees, they're taxes. And anyways, I'm getting into too much detail right now, but I just wanted to let you know the subject matter jurisdiction that's being called into question. What the defense is claiming is that they have personal jurisdiction over the case, but they don't have jurisdiction over the subject matter being discussed. And so we'll go ahead and get into the update now. Hi everyone. I wanted to share with you an update that I got from Arnold Law. I received it yesterday afternoon, but I wanted to look in to some information that I gathered to see how Ammon's defense lines up with what I have found in my own research. I wanted to go ahead and share this update with you. There'll be follow-ups later because I believe I understand where Ammon Bundy is coming from. First off, he starts out by taking the narrative back. He wants to set people straight because the shallow and uninformed media portrayals and government hyperbole, which is really a nice way of saying bullshit, you know, that they're calling Ammon an extremist or... But he wants you guys to know he's not a member of any militia, patriot group, or political land protest organization. With this motion, he wants to set it straight. He labels, I'm not going to read the whole thing. You guys can read it for yourself since it's up on the screen. But as he understands federalism, his genuine belief in originalism, coupled with his own personal life experience, that he, like a grown body of significant thinkers across the United States, has challenged the federal government's overreach, speaking out against its attendant injustices, and rallying attention to the core questions of federal land ownership and related abuses. This topic is a red-hot issue, especially in the western states. And like I have mentioned before on my other videos, you know, the federal government claims to own over 80-some-odd percent of Nevada. I don't know how that could be if Nevada entered in on equal footing with the rest of the states. But I'll show you guys that, you know, us so-called patriots or constitutional originalists that believe in the original intent, what the founders had in mind, we don't believe that the Constitution is a living, breathing document, because that tends, that term that's used, living, breathing Constitution, means that it changes with time, not with amendments, okay? There is no amendment process, even though it's written in the Constitution that changes to the documents are supposed to be done through amendments. Over the years, that's not how it's been done. Instead, what's happened is they have twisted the definitions of the words or the terms that were used during the creation and signing of the Constitution. Over the years, they've twisted the meaning of those words to mean something else, and then they've added to them. For instance, the power to tax. The federal government was never given the power to tax people's wages, okay? And you can look at Supreme Court rulings that also say that.
Antonin Scalia, quote, "The Constitution that I interpret and apply is not living, but dead," close quote. Explain that one.
Much of the harm that has been done in recent years by activist constitutional interpretation is made possible by a theory which says that, unlike an ordinary law, which doesn't change, it means what it meant when it was enacted, and will always mean that. Unlike that, the Constitution changes from decade to decade to comport with, and this is a phrase we use in our Eighth Amendment jurisprudence, we, the court does, to comport with, quote, the evolving standards of decency that mark the progress of a maturing society. In other words, we have a morphing constitution. And of course, it's up to the court to decide when it morphs and how it morphs. That's generally paraded as the, quote, living constitution. And unfortunately, that philosophy has made enormous headway, not only with lawyers and judges, but even with John Q. Public.
But getting back to this, I just wanted you to know, an originalist believes in the original intent for which the Constitution was written, okay? Not like the liberalism today, where they apply all this liberal meaning. I have some other videos on that if you guys want to take a look at that. But anyways, he states he's an originalist. He also sees himself as a well-established and well-respected family man, entrepreneur, and politically active United States citizen. He states that he is challenging the federal government's overreach, speaking out against its injustices, and rallying attention to the core question of federal land ownership. And that's what all of this is about. He said Ammon Bundy's peaceful protest at the refuge was an act of civil disobedience and a calculated legal maneuver through adverse possession, 43 U.S. Code 1068. The title of that is Lands Held in Adverse Possession. And you guys can go look at that on the internet if you just Google 43 U.S. Code 1064. It'll pop up and you can read over it and see that there are some good issues that they are raising about this law, okay? The very legal issue that Mr. Bundy sought to clarify, which remains unresolved from a constitutional basis, provides the foundation for his criminal prosecution of Mr. Bundy. He contends that the constitutional challenge to the federal government's jurisdiction over the land in question must be resolved before proceeding with the prosecution of Ammon Bundy, if indeed any grounds remain upon which to mount the legitimate prosecution. And I love this because he's challenging the law, is what he's doing. Just because you say you have jurisdiction, it doesn't mean you do. You have to prove it, okay? And it has been cited in numerous cases, even in the U.S. Supreme Court. You have to prove jurisdiction. To say you have it is not enough. So he's saying that instead of arguing the issue in a civil courtroom through an ejectment proceeding where such debate belongs, Mr. Bundy finds himself before federal criminal court as a prisoner. So there's an assumption that they already have jurisdiction over these lands to regulate them. And I'm going to show you, I don't think, I read over the filings of his attorneys, and it's a pretty good case, but I didn't see anything in there even referencing the Nevada Constitution and what it says. So we'll go over that in a minute too, because I'll show you that there was a repeal to the ordinance in the Nevada Constitution, and the legislators at the time in 1993 through 95, they could see the burden that these multiple federal agencies were putting on these lands through regulations and stuff like that. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and tell you. Mr. Bundy finds himself before a federal criminal court as a prisoner. Ammon and the Citizens for Constitutional Freedom might not have prevailed in their adverse possession claim, but that was for a civil court to decide. If the government would have acted with a remote degree of competence, it would have challenged the adverse possession with an ejectment or eviction claim. Then Ammon would have responded in court, and the court would have heard our defense based upon 43 U.S. Code 1068. Lands held in adverse possession, another relevant federal law, which taken together unquestionably provides legitimacy to the protesters' attempts. The western states are not treated equally by the federal government. Washington, D.C. controls approximately 50% of the land in 11 western states, and like I said, over 80% of the land in Nevada. The management of the land is not only out of step with the priorities and economies of local, state, and municipal governments, it's also out of line with the letter and spirit of the Constitution. The legality of this position is a matter for open debate because it's never been properly challenged in a court of law. And that's true. If anybody's ever done the research on this, you'll find that this specific issue, I haven't been able to find any cases on it either. It'll your search will route you to all of these cases not pertaining to such things. While it may seem absurd that such a gaping constitutional question remains in 2016, consider that it's an issue primarily concerning the people of western states, and specifically those living in remote and lightly populated areas. It has simply taken a very long time for those marginalized people who are adversely affected by the unconstitutional policies to mount a viable opposition. The state of Utah, where the federal government owns over 61% of the lands, found that mounting a legal challenge to the current federal land policy would cost more than $13 million, a price tag beyond the reach of the citizens most aggrieved. Ammon Bundy, who has personal experience with the federal government's aggressive and forceful enforcement of their unconstitutional land management policy, deliberately and thoughtfully intervened when there was a growing and disorganized unrest regarding the unusual and aggressive prosecution of the Hammond family in Oregon. His solution was to stage a lawful and coordinated adverse occupation of the Malheur Wildlife Refuge. Ammon's intent... Okay, so hold on a minute. So what they're calling a conspiracy, the federal government has charged him with conspiracy, but according to Arnold Law, he says his solution was to stage a lawful and coordinated adverse occupation. Okay, so they're stating what they did was, it was lawful what they did. And what they're calling conspiracy, federal government's calling a conspiracy, it was a coordinated occupation. So, you know, two different terms really mean the same thing, except for the fact that Ammon says what he did was lawful. Okay? Ammon's intent with the occupation was to force the issue into civil court, where he could properly challenge the constitutionality of the government's position. However, the government's response was to ambush the leaders with overwhelming force and in the process kill LaBoy Finnegan. Ammon Bundy argues that the criminal charges against Ammon and other protesters should be dropped on the basis that the federal government does not have clear constitutional rights to land where the occupation was held. Moreover, it's time to address the disparity of the federal land policy between the eastern and western states and resolve the long unanswered question of whether the federal government has the constitutional right to own and manage the majority of land within any single state. Okay? It is disproportionate that the government, the United States government, claims ownership of 50% of all the lands in the western states, as well as more than 60% of Alaska, while only claiming 4% of the land in the rest of the country and 39 states combined. Most relevant to this case, the United States claims permanent ownership of 81% of the land inside the boundaries of Nevada, 66.5% inside Utah, 61% inside Idaho, and 53% inside of Oregon. Guys, that's insane, okay? And if you lived here in Nevada or in any of these western states, you could see the insanity of it. Does the Constitution of the United States via the Property Clause of of Article 4, Section 3 permit the federal government's permanent ownership and exclusive jurisdiction over public lands. If not, it also prevents the government from exercising jurisdiction here, and this case must be dismissed. Ammon Bundy is aware of the many federal court decisions and modern public discussions on the issue, and the core purpose of the Malheur protest was to raise within that discussion the primary legal question at hand, based upon a significant distinction. The issue as presented here is not whether Congress has the plenary power to manage and regulate public lands, or decide to sell some or withhold others from sale. There is no question with the constraints of the Constitution. Congress has plenary power to manage and regulate the property it lawfully owns. This power was established, and the legal question settled long ago. What the Supreme Court has never addressed is whether Congress can forever retain the majority of land within a state, and in this case specifically, whether the Constitution permits the federal government's purported ownership and jurisdiction over land and property occupied by Mr. Bundy and the Citizens for Constitutional Freedom beginning on January 2, 2016. See, I really like how this argument is going, because he's right, it's never been addressed. If you ever have taken the time to do your research on this, the major issue that I have found in all the research is there was always an assumption that they had jurisdiction to regulate. So people never raised the question of jurisdiction. That's why if they went to court, they lost their case. And Clive and Bundy, he doesn't recognize the federal government's jurisdiction because they've never proven they had it. Okay, and if you look through the court cases, they never proved they had it there. It was just assumed. People never challenged the question. Okay, can a state, was it constitutional for a state to enter into the union, relinquishing the majority of the state land to the federal government? I mean, it seems like a contradiction. And I'll tell you where the issue arises. Okay. Nevada was a land acquired through conquest. I'm sorry. When let me get the information on the treaty. Okay. The Mexican Succession of 1848. The lands that were succeeded to the United States in 1848, I can't remember if it was for 13 million or 15 million, but the treaty between Mexico and the United States gave up California, Nevada, Utah, parts of Colorado, New Mexico, and Arizona. I mean, it took half of Mexico when we conquered them, and they actually purchased the land, okay? And like I said, it was for 13 or 15 million. So what happened after that was these lands were territories of the United States, okay? They weren't states. They were not entered into the Union. What had to happen is they had to have the land survey and plotted and all that kind of stuff, and the boundaries drawn. And so it was a territory until it was admitted into the Union. And the, I'm trying to think, I have it. Let me pull this up so you guys can see that. Okay, so here's some research I edited just today. And the Constitution of the State of Nevada was approved by Congress on March 21st, 1864, where Nevada was admitted into the Union. And here's where I question the management you know, their jurisdiction or authority to manage the land, okay? There's an ordinance written at the very beginning of the state of Nevada Constitution. In part, it says that the people inhabiting said territory do agree and declare that they forever disclaim all rights and title to unappropriated public lands lying within said territory, and that the same shall be and remain at the sole and entire disposition of the United States. But at that time, when it was a territory, when it was conquered in 1848, 16 years later, when Nevada was entered into the Union on equal footing with other states, they disclaimed the right and title to these unappropriated lands. And it says right here, for the United States to have the sole and entire disposition, okay? And if you do your research, you'll find out that there were numerous foreign claims on these lands. You know, I mean, you have to remember, we were, the governments were battling each other. You had the French over here making treaties with the Mexicans. You had the French making treaties with other states, all this kind of stuff that caused the federal government to be created, and it gave them right to make treaties and stuff like that. And then the states weren't allowed to do it anymore. Okay, so that power was granted to the federal government. So Nevada became a state, and at that time, I think it was like 97% of the land was actually federal territory, okay? But the key here is unappropriated public lands, okay? Well, the federal government has appropriated many of those lands. In one instance, the Bundys, there was public lands appropriated for grazing, okay? So once those lands are appropriated, who has the power to manage them? The Constitution, the U.S. Constitution, does not give the federal government the authority to manage appropriated public lands within a state, okay? Once the federal government, according to the Nevada Constitution, once those lands are appropriated, the management of it should be turned over to the state, because the state of Nevada didn't relinquish their right to manage it. And here's how I know that I'm right on this. Because people assume that the rights and title that were given up to unappropriated public lands in the territory, once they were appropriated by the federal government, then the federal government could go ahead and regulate them. But I would like to show you how I know that that's not true. In 1993, the Nevada legislators passed a resolution. It's Senate Joint Resolution number 27, the Committee on Natural Resources, and it's filed under 189. And here's what it says. It's on page 3136. The state of Nevada has a strong moral claim upon the public land retained by the federal government within Nevada's borders. Okay? The federal government didn't dispose of these lands as originally agreed that they were going to do. So here's what it says. On October 31st, 1864, the territory of Nevada was admitted to statehood on the condition that it forever disclaimed rights and title to unappropriated public lands. And Nevada received the least amount of lands, 2.5 acres, the smallest percentage of its total area, 3.9% of the land granted states in the far west, admitted after 1864. That's ridiculous. So 96.1%, 97% of the land in the state was still owned by the federal government. Today it's like 84, 86, something like that. So in all, over all these years, it's only increased around 9%. The state of Texas, when admitted to the Union, retained ownership of all its unappropriated lands within the borders. So it goes on to say, the federal holdings in the state of Nevada constitute 86.7% of the area of the state. And in Esmeralda, Lincoln, Mineral, Nye, White Pine counties, the federal government controls from 97 to 99% of the land. And the federal jurisdiction over public domain is shared among several federal agencies or departments, which causes problems concerning the proper management of the land and disrupts the normal relationship between a state, its residents, and its property. And the intent of the framers of the Constitution of the United States was to guarantee to each state sovereignty over all matters within its boundaries, except for those powers specifically granted to the United States as an agent of the states. Okay, so the Nevada legislators are pointing this out, the very thing that Ammon is pointing out too. Okay? And the exercise of the dominion and control of public lands within the state of Nevada by the United States works a severe, continuous, and debilitating hardship upon the people of the state of Nevada. Now therefore it be. Now therefore be it. Okay, so the legislators in 1993 recognized this hardship and also recognized the intent of the framers of the Constitution of the United States was to guarantee to each of the states sovereignty over all matters within its boundaries, except for those powers specifically granted to the United States as an agent of the states. So the federal government, their actions are supposed to align with the U.S. Constitution. Well, the U.S. Constitution allows them to own property for specific needful purposes, okay? What is the needful purpose of the federal government not selling these lands, but leasing them out and then charging permit fees? I mean, somebody else is using that land, okay? Where does the federal government get its authority to manage land that is being owned or used by someone else other than the federal government? They don't. They don't have that power. It was never even implied in the U.S. Constitution. They could buy certain land for certain purposes, and because they are the owners of it, and they were going to be the users of it, then they could set the regulations thereof. But they're not using these lands. The people within the states are using these lands, okay? And the federal government was never given the power to regulate land owned or used by a person within a state, okay? And the states didn't give up that power to do that. Only on unapportioned land in a territory. That's what the Nevada Constitution says. And in 1993, or in 1995, there was a repeal to this. And here's what the new ordinance says today, and if you go Google it on the internet, you'll be able to find this. The federal jurisdiction over the public domain is shared among federal agencies or in departments, which causes problems concerning the proper management of the land and disrupts normal relationships between a state, its residents, and its property. And the intent of the framers of the Constitution was to guarantee that each state, that the states had sovereignty over matters within its boundaries, except for those powers granted to the United States as an agent of the state. For instance, the power to make treaties, okay? Here's where it changed. This was stricken on file number 54 in 1995, page 2917. This is what was stricken from the ordinance. That the people inhabiting said territory do decree and declare that lands belonging to the citizens of the United States, you know, should never be taxed higher than the lands belonging to the residents. Okay, do you see this red here? They forever disclaim all rights and titles to unappropriated public lands lying within said territory You see how that struck through? Okay, so they no longer are disclaiming rights and titles to unappropriated public lands because there's not any anymore, okay? These lands have been appropriated, okay? Most of them have. What hasn't is up on the auction block right now, the BLM is selling. But the land that the Bundys are using and that the federal government wants grazing fees for, it's been appropriated for grazing, okay? It's been appropriated. What happened? Okay? Where is the federal government getting the jurisdiction to regulate these lands? It's not in the U.S. Constitution. It's not in the Nevada Constitution to regulate the lands, okay? In analyzing the enclave and property clauses prior to courts have erroneously begun with the premise that because the lands were assumed to be public, then the property clause provided broad authority to federal government to regulate it. Defendants urge this court to begin with a different premise, that these lands were unconstitutionally acquired, unconstitutionally maintained, and are not therefore simply public lands. The property clause rules that the government is empowered to make are only those that are needful lands. That's what I was telling you earlier. It has to have a needful purpose. And the only land upon which those rules can be made are lands constitutionally acquired, owned, maintained under Article 1. Although courts have presumed that the property clause allows the federal government to retain land, that position is simply untenable in light of the history and structure of the relevant constitutional provisions. Raising this question and reaching the point of this motion has been no small challenge for Mr. Bundy and his colleagues. In 2015, the legislator for the state of Utah commissioned a legal analysis to investigate and report on the plausibility of contesting the federal government's continued assertion of ownership and title to Western lands. Significantly, after concluding that there was a legitimate legal basis for challenging the constitutionality of federal land ownership, the study also concluded that bringing it to federal court would require an estimated budget of $13,819,000. Clearly, with this price tag, individual citizens like the Hammonds and Mr. Bundy could never realistically bring the challenge, despite their undisputable right to petition their government for redress. So basically, what he's saying is that, you know, he had to plan this protest in order to get arrested. Then it could be heard in court. This is the route of the government. You can be heard once you're arrested. There's no other way to protest, you know, or to have a redress of grievance actually addressed. You know, and for many of you guys that signed those petitions on whitehouse.gov's website, you should know that. I think Obama said any protest that, or any petition that had got more than 100,000 signatures would be addressed by the president. Isn't that what he said? And to this date, I can't remember him addressing any of them. So I could be wrong on that, but we should check that out because, I mean, where's the, you know, redress for grievances? Where's the IRS, you know, won't even address the protesters protesting the tax laws? So at this impromptu meeting, and in the presence of local law enforcement, Ammon openly advocated a special plan to organize and to continue the protest. Ryan Bundy verbally offered a second to the proposed plan, and LaVoy Finicum spoke in support of it. Neither of these men had previously heard of, let alone participated in the formation of Ammon's plan. Prior to this, Ammon was not the leader of any group related to the Hammond protest. Following the meeting, Ammon and his just organized, yeah, this is true, because he named his group on, you know, public TV. Citizens for Constitutional Freedom embarked upon his newly organized protest in earnest effort to set up and maintain a lawful adverse possession claim on purported federal lands. The lands and property had been generally known as the Mahlon National Wildlife Refuge and were directly related to the Hammond controversy. And that evening, the Citizens for Constitutional Freedom began the process of carrying out the ubiquitous requirements for a lawful adverse possession claim. After notifying the local sheriff's office, they secured their claim, including land, property, and vacant building, and openly took control and management of the same. Consistent with the purpose of the protest, they notoriously renamed the area the Harney County Resource Center. They contacted the utility company to take over responsibility for utilities and services and began working the property and maintaining the perimeter, controlling ingress and egress. Ammon and his fellow protesters then invited the public to visit their claim. They carried out cleaning, upkeep, and maintenance, and they welcomed over 1,000 visitors, including elected officials, prominent political leaders. Further, the USFWS staff was granted access, and no one from the federal government ever made a direct contact demanding that the attempted adverse possession end. They never made direct contact with them. Ammon and the citizens. Oh, that's very true, because the only one that ever came out to tell Ammon to leave was the sheriff. And that was after many days of being there. And he said, look, we'll give you safe passage to the border. And Ammon's like, yeah, right, no. So no one from the federal government ever made a direct contact demanding that the attempted adverse possession end. Ammon and the Citizens for Constitutional Freedom may not have prevailed in their adverse possession claim, but that's for a civil court to decide. If the government would have acted with a remote degree of competence, it would have challenged the adverse possession with an ejectment of eviction claim. Then Ammon would have responded. Well, that is the legal process, you know, for getting him off the land. Wow. Ammon would have responded in court, and the court would have heard our defense based upon 43 U.S. Code 1068. Lands held in adverse possession. Another relevant federal law which taken together unquestionably provides legitimacy to the protesters' attempt. But that was not the government's response. Despite no overt acts of force or violence by Mr. Bundy or the occupiers itself, the federal government ambushed and used overwhelming force to arrest Mr. Bundy, and in the process killed his friend and fellow activist and protester, Lavoie Finicum. Thus, while the executive branch of the federal government has used its unmatched muscle and might to forcibly end the Malheur occupation, it did not end the protest. The use of force cannot answer the present question. By virtue of their attempted adverse possession of purportedly federal property, Mr. Bundy and the citizens now have secured the legal standing they sought to raise the issue in federal court. They did not have $13 million to buy their place in court today, but they did pay a significant price. As the court is well aware, it has cost Mr. Bundy, approximately 24 members of the citizens, more than 100 days of their liberty under extreme harsh conditions, and most poignantly, it has cost the blood of a well-loved rancher, family man, and deeply principled patriot of the United States. I had to take a break, guys. Sorry about that, guys. I had to take a little break. Okay, we'll continue with this update. For 150 years, the federal government maintained a policy of disposing of public lands. The result was that the state governments had complete jurisdiction over nearly all the territory within their borders, giving those states the same opportunity for settlement, development, preservation, conservation of parks and recreation area, and the promotion of culture and commerce that the original states received. But west of the 104 degree meridian, circumstances changed. The federal government has treated states west of that line unequally. It has allowed those states dominion over only a small percentage of the land within their borders, and under an even more expansive modern view of federal land ownership. Western states cannot fully advance commerce. They cannot develop the tax base necessary to fund schools, build roads, finance higher education. They cannot build transit and communication systems common in each in eastern states because privately owned lands are broken up by intervening federal lands that states cannot condemn for such public improvement. A western state like Oregon cannot control its own destiny. And this is no more true. You can clearly see this in Nevada, okay? Where, you know, housing prices are freaking out the wall because they're saying we're running out of land to build on. Well, that's because the federal government is in possession, you know, of almost 90% of the land to date. And, you know, it's been 152 years since the state of Nevada entered the Union. And the federal government has yet to relinquish or dispose of these lands, okay? They chose at some point to start managing them. I don't know, and Ammon's attorney don't know, and Ammon doesn't know, and the Bundy family doesn't know, and the Hammonds don't know where they get the authority to manage these lands within the states. Okay, an individual has a direct interest. Ammon Bundy is asking the court to rule on this issue now. An individual has a direct interest in objecting to laws that upset the constitutional balance between the national government and states when the enforcement of those laws causes injury that is concrete, particular, and redressable. Bond versus U.S. The defendant Ammon Bundy organized his fellow citizens in protest of the expansive and unsupported interpretation of the Constitution that purports to allow the federal government to own and control more territory and exercise jurisdiction over land in the western states than the states themselves. The discrete question raised has not been ruled upon by the Ninth Circuit or the United States Supreme Court. And I thought I was missing something, but I've been researching this since 2012 and I have not found a case either. So what they're saying, it does coincide with my research, but I've been watching to see what would happen. You know, the presumptions based upon the expansive application of the property clause are unjustified by the text of the Constitution, unsupported by the history and related founding era understanding, and directly destructive to the principles of federalism. The Hammonds are a classic case where federal bureaucracy won the day, and the Hammonds have been to prison twice. During the Mollier protest and occupation, U.S. Representative Greg Walden addressed this exact consequence on the floor of Congress, when on January 5, 2016, he explained that even he had sponsored and passed key legislation to limit the BLM. And despite the legislation passing, the bureaucrats simply refused to be governed. Commenting on his floor speech, Congressman Walden said, "I got up there and 17 years of working with farmers and ranchers and folks in eastern Oregon just poured out." If you guys didn't see that speech, it is on YouTube to view. It's quite the quite a moving speech he gave. But I take it with a grain of salt because I know that they're allowed to get up on that floor and lie through their teeth. So this is what Justice Roberts warned about when he cited James Madison in Federalist Number 45. The framers thus ensured that powers which, in the ordinary course of affairs, concern the lives, liberties, and property of the people were held by governments more local, more accountable than a distant federal bureaucracy. Defendant finally brings this motion as a culminating act of civil activism, not just his, but all those thousands of individual citizens who protest, visited, and supported the attempted adverse possession and related work at the Harney County Resource Center. Sometimes civil activity in a free society can be uncomfortable for the government. It is usually then that institutions like this court should pay special attention. There is no other way that federalism can ultimately preserve liberty, allowing those who seek a voice in shaping the destiny of their own times without having to rely solely upon the political processes that control a remote central power. The current claim by the federal government to the ownership and exclusive jurisdiction over public lands within states, including the specific land at issue here, are plainly prohibited by the Constitution of the United States. The court should therefore dismiss this action for lack of subject matter jurisdiction, and thereby ensure that federalism still protects the liberty of all persons within a state by ensuring that laws enacted in excess of delegated government power cannot direct or control their actions. While the protests in this case are charged with crimes in Oregon, there is undoubtedly a federal district of Oregon. The ownership of this land is critical to determining whether the protesters can even be charged with committing federal crimes. Defendants assert this case should be dismissed and reserves the right to supplement this record, as well as argue at the appropriate time for evidence and jury instructions consistent with the lack of lawful duties alleged in the indictment. Yours truly, Mike Arnold. And just for your own information, I'd like to go over some more things with you. Between the 2 years of 1993, when the Nevada legislators proposed this repeal of that amendment of the ordinance in the Nevada Constitution, within that 2 year period of October 1992 through 95, the Inspector General audit reported 3 violations of law and regulations during the sell and purchase exchange of 3 of the 4 transactions audited. 75%, and of this audit that they did on the BLM records, found that 3 out of 4 violated laws and regulations, okay? And I'll tell you specifically what the report says. I'll scroll down here a little bit. Okay. We found that while the Nevada State Office had acquired some high-quality properties by exchanging lands with private entities, it did not consistently follow prescribed land exchange regulations or procedures to ensure that a fair and equitable value was received in completing 3 of the 4 exchanges we reviewed. In some instances, this occurred because state office management wanted to expedite the exchanges, given that the proponent had willing buyers available or land purchase options that were close to expiring. In other instances, management proceeded with an exchange in a certain manner without documenting the rationale used to support the action. As a result, the State Office Exchange Bureau land for 2,461 acres of private land valued at $2.7 million. That was not in conformance with current land use plans and therefore had no discernible mission-related purpose. In addition, the government may have lost about $4.4 million in completing 3 of the exchanges. Okay, so let's go back to this, okay? The federal government, can own property for forts and arsenals, whatever that wording is, and of other needful purposes. But right here, the audit in 1995 clearly states that purchase or swapping certain lands had no discernible mission-related purpose, had no purpose for doing what they did. The government may have lost about $4.4 million in completing 3 of the exchanges reviewed. Okay? So what she's pretty much saying is what they did was unconstitutional because the land that they acquired or exchanged had no purpose. Okay? And it wasn't even within the original plan. It gets worse. We also found that in 3 of the 4 exchanges, the state office exchanged a total of 446 acres of federal land within the land sale area designated by the Santini-Burton Act. The Santini-Burton legislation does not specifically prohibit the Bureau from exchanging lands in the sale area under the authorities provided. However, it is clear that Congress intended that proceeds from the sale within the designated area would be used to offset the cost incurred for the Lake Tahoe Basin, under which to keep the cost of enacting the Santini-Burton legislation nominal. We conclude that because these lands were exchanged rather than sold, sales revenue of at least $9.2 million were not generated, of which about $7.8 million would have been remitted to the U.S. Secretary, the U.S. Treasury. Okay, so there was a plan in place of what land to get rid of, what to retain, and all of this. And what this audit is saying is the BLM went out and did whatever they wanted to do, not what was intended. Okay, the Tahoe Basin acquisition cost $93 million, reportedly exceeded the sales revenue remitted to the U.S. Treasury of $40 million. Wow. Man, that's a bad business deal. And this is why our federal government constantly carries a deficit, because they were taught common core math. Here's the most ridiculous one. Finally, we noted that the state office initiated an exchange of 25 acres of the Bureau's Las Vegas area lands valued at $665,000 in order to obtain a defunct bowling alley, with the intent of using the facility as an administrative complex for the Tonopah Resource Area. We provided information on this exchange because we believe that such exchanges may not represent the most effective use of federal land, and because the Bureau personnel said that additional proposals to acquire administrative facilities through land exchanges may be forthcoming based on the precedent set at Tonopah. Okay? So show me where in the U.S. Constitution it says that a federal agency or an agency of the federal government can buy a bowling alley. I mean, come on, people. So my personal opinion that I have about this whole land stuff was pretty much validated by this update that I received from Arnold Law yesterday afternoon. Okay. You could go to media.oregonlive.com and you can actually read the document he filed yesterday. It's 33 pages long, and it's his motion to dismiss for lack of subject matter jurisdiction. So, and it does say, you know, that Ammon admits the personal jurisdiction of the court, but he's challenging the subject matter jurisdiction. Okay? And it's very interesting because right here it also says fellow protester Ryan Bundy expressly joins in bringing this motion before the court. Okay? Any other thing in here, but you can go through here and look. It's very informative. It's just another document I'm going to add to my research. I don't know how the federal government is going to explain themselves. I can imagine they're going to treat this case and his argument as frivolous, because that is what they do with tax protesters that have actually done their research, you know, like Joe Bannister, who was once an IRS special agent. And he resigned because he did his own research and found that the majority of people paying income tax are not required to by law. And if you actually take the time to research the law yourself, You know, you'll find that much of what the federal government is doing through the bureaucracy I call the fourth branch, the administrative branch of government, much of what they're doing, they don't have the authority and power to do because it was never granted to Congress or the executive branch or the judicial branch. So if the original three branches of government weren't allowed to do certain things, where is the authority coming from this fourth branch? I mean, it was never granted to them. And I've shown you the Nevada Constitution. You'll have to go look at the U.S. Constitution yourself. But I have yet to find, you know, where they came up with the authority to manage land within a state. I know they have a right to dispose of it unless they have useful purposes for it, and they're going to be using it. Useful purposes, needful, useful purposes. But where they're not using the land, what gives them the right to regulate it, to write regulations? And especially when other people are using it, how can you regulate land that you are not using? So I am glad that Arnold Law is aware of this, and I'm tired, so I'm going to go ahead and let you guys go, and hopefully you'll do your own research on the matter and share what you've learned. So thanks.